Hey guys, Dylan from the Geek Duo here, and today I'll be bringing you my reaction to Moon Knight Season 1, Episode 2, titled Summon the Suit. As Steven reels from the fact that his life may not be his own, a mysterious partner emerges from the past as a war of the gods looms on the horizon. Okay, so last episode was very weird, seeing something from a single perspective of a person who has multiple personality was extremely jarring. Like, I couldn't imagine living life like that, just knowing that parts of my day could be missed, or even days could be missed because there's another personality controlling my body. But I am seriously wondering if either this episode or further down the line, we are actually going to see Mark's perspective of that, those 4 days. Because it's going to be very interesting to see what happens. But I guess we'll find out when we start this episode in 3, 2, 1, go. Why didn't that work? Like, it didn't even come up. Let's try again. 3, 2, 1, go. There we go. That time it did the opposite of what usually happens, where it started playing but didn't go in there. Oops. Also, I think I called him Ethan Hunt last night. Or, which, if I'm not mistaken, is the guy from Mission Impossible. Like, the character. His name's Ethan Hawke. Yeah. So, I'll fuck that up. I'll admit that. Is this still the Jackal, or...? Ow. Is it going to be all smashed up, or did they somehow get that fixed? I'm going to guess it's the former. It's gonna be first post. Guess there's no, Apparently that guy's named after one of Moon Knight's acquaintances in the comics, at least in credits, so. Mate, why don't you have lights that just turn on all at once? It's much easier. I'm tempted to scan that QR code. That's more than just a storage unit. That's I guess that's where Mark lives or lived. I still don't know, why did the jackal show up on... Then again, it never actually interacted with anything in the episode, so... Sure, it knocked down the door, but other than that, it didn't actually collide with anything. Okay, so it is a form of compass. A bit narcissistic, ain't it? Ooh, that, can't you? Hello, big guy. Oh, shit. Yeah, so those two are definitely in Harrow's cult. Shouldn't have taken the bag. Excuse me. Why don't you ever just say he's your twin brother? Like, that... Just say that. I don't think this is police station. There it is. How far does that reach? Now that's the question. Apparently that's a big question with Moon Knight, and there's conflicting reports from comics. So he knows English, Mandarin, ancient Egyptian. Was he talking to Arthur or Stephen when he said that? How does a goddess have a tomb? Like, she was the one that Anubis fed those who failed his test to. He shrunk away from that. Oh, that's glowing. Why would you do that? You're summoning another underworld beast, aren't you? Yep. Let me in, let me in. Ow. Mr. Knight. Oh. That's the... I like it. Ow. So it can interact with the physical world, just... Fuck. Great work, Steven. Ow. Hammer space, okay. Is it really hammer space if you can just pull off infinite? Fucking hell. Didn't even test that guy. I mean, I can obviously tell he's in Egypt. They don't need to do this whole dramatic... Okay, that episode was still weird. It was a lot more coherent than the first episode, but weird. Seeing the dichotomy between Steven and Mark, and also the very old argument of whether it's better for vengeance to punish after the crime or to stop a crime from happening in the first place. So that's the whole moral quandary of this whole series, I'm guessing. Who is in the right? Vengeance or pre-punishment? And I am in no place to give an answer on that because... Yeah, there is the appeal in the punishing before, but you have no right to do it because you can still change their... There's still a chance it could change, so... If they were to use Amit's power to find the people who had the chance of doing wrong in the future and then... stop them from doing that in a less lethal way, then yeah, I'd say Amit's in the right, but it's not. It's the whole killing them before they've done it. Something that we have no proof they'd even actually do, but... It's always weird when the hero and the villain come together and both make arguments that sort of make sense. Like, you can tell the villain is obviously more in the wrong than the hero, but Mark's way of, well, Khonshu's way of doing it isn't that much better, as it's still... Sorry. Yeah. Just did a Pepsi burp out my nose. Ugh. Anyway, Khonshu's way is not much better with, as he's still killing people. Yes, those people have actually done the wrong thing. However, what exactly is the extent to which he deems punishable? Like, that old lady in the first episode apparently would have done something in her future. What exactly was it? What is the severity of that? And no matter what it is, most people would say not punishable by death. But on the other hand, we also don't know what conscious limits are. He says he punishes those who have hurt innocent people. That can be interpreted a lot of ways. And to what extent of hurt? Like, if it's only those who have physically hurt people, is it those who have killed others? Or so much as intentionally given someone a broken nose? Like, those do not all deserve to be... have the shit kicked out of them, and most of them killed. Like, but I guess we're going to find out later on what Khonshu is, what the limits to them, why we're following Khonshu instead of, say, him also being tied to an antagonist, so to say. But, yeah, it's very interesting. Anyway, I don't really have much to say about this episode. It was nice seeing the back and forth between Mark and Steven when Steven was controlling the body, and then again when Mark was in control. Still want to know if we're going to get Jake in this show. By the looks of it, the answer is no. But there's every opportunity. I wonder if... because there's something coming later this year. The Werewolf by Night Halloween special. And Moon Knight's first appearance was apparently in Werewolf by Night. So, will there be a stinger at the end of this series, like how there was at the end of Eternals, where Mark goes to see the person who either is or will become Werewolf by Night, or vice versa, is visited by that person? Because I don't know who that... I don't know anything about that person. I didn't even know that was a character until I started looking into Moon Knight a little bit more. Because we had Blade come see Dane Whitman at the end of Eternals. And so they could do something similar. I also... like, obviously, I know that there are many different versions of Moon Knight. Like, there's Steven, there's Mark, and there's Jake in the human form. There's Moon Knight, and there's Mr. Knight as the costumed version. I don't know if those are actually different. I don't know if they're different from their human versions. As I said, I've never actually read a Moon Knight comic. But we did get to see the Mr. Knight costume in this episode, which seems to be Steven's preferred version of the suit. Whereas Mark goes the traditional route of Khonshu's avatar's uniform. And I wonder, if they do bring him in, would Jake have the more comic version where it's all cloth, sort of halfway between them? It's also interesting to find out that Harrow was Khonshu's previous avatar. Because Khonshu didn't deny it. Like, you sure he could be lying, but he obviously is familiar enough with the way this Khonshu is personality-wise to know exactly what he was telling Mark at the time that he was telling it to. Sorry, telling Steven at the time that he was telling it to. And so that does lead credence to him actually having been the Avatar. And I'm guessing he... similarly to Mark, he died, was resurrected by Khonshu before passing through the Field of Reeds. And that his service was also his payment for being brought back. As they pretty much said in this episode. But how did he get free of Khonshu's control? And how did he go to Amit after? And also, having it been confirmed that Steven did die and was found by Khonshu leads credence to the fact that he did get denied the Field of Reeds. However, I'm guessing his heart wasn't fed to Amit, given the fact that she's entombed somewhere. And also, Khonshu may have intervened. So how did that little girl in the first episode know that he'd been denied? And also, we know Helheim exists from the Norse mythology. So what distinguishes between which one you go to? Plus the whole, they might be bringing in Zeus and the Olympian pantheon in Thor, Love, and Thunder. So what stops someone from going to Hades instead of whatever the Egyptians called their underworld in Helheim? Or what stops them from going to hell when they bring Mephisto in? If they bring Mephisto in. This is what I wonder every time there's something that's like, oh yeah, multiple forms of mythology exist, and they are different entities rather than being different interpretations of the same person. Like, you go Greek and Roman. They're just different versions of the same gods. Some gods got condensed into a single being when turning Roman. Some gods got split into several when becoming Roman. Most, if not all of them, became more militarized than their Greek counterparts. However, they're these essentially just different interpretations that reflect the values of the societies that they're with, yet their underworld and their paradise and all that are essentially the same. So then you turn to Egyptian, where they don't exactly have the same thing. Like, they've got essentially a purgatory and what is paradise. They don't really, from my understanding, again, I never got into Egyptian mythology, they didn't exactly have a hell-like thing. And then you've got Norse mythology, where they have Valhalla, or Vanaheim, depending on whether you go with the Aesir or the Vanir. If you die in battle, they've got Niflheim, which is essentially purgatory, and then they've got Helheim, which is for the dishonored dead. And again, different versions essentially could just be a reskinned Greek, but their gods are again completely different. And the fact that they've got two different versions of paradise, just, so what distinguishes between? I know I've gone completely off topic. I'm meant to be talking about the episode, but I need to get this out. Like, how did they get chosen as to where they go? Plus, it is full Marvel canon that Mephisto rules over hell. I don't know if there is a heaven. Is there a heaven in Marvel canon? I don't know. And I heard somewhere that each of the different religions' versions of hell is just a pocket of the one that Mephisto rules. But who's to say that Mephisto's hell is not also within? And just, it's confusing, man. Also, I have a bad habit of, whenever I hear a British person talking, sort of adopting their mannerisms, like the innit or bruv. And same happens when I'm talking with a New Zealander. Same happens slightly if it's Scottish or Irish, but I don't mean to do it. I know it's not good quality when I do it, but you're going to keep hearing me every time Steven's on screen and I'm talking. There's going to be a little bit of an inflection. Anyway, I need to stop this now before I keep rambling. I'll catch you in the next one.